What is Robexotica? You might ask yourself. And one, two, three, I'm going to just tell you. It's an annual festival that we are holding in Vienna. And it's everything that has to do with robots and cocktails and the various interfaces between those two interesting things in life. And as you can see here, we've got, or maybe if you can read German, you can see that we have exhibition, we have talks, we have live music, we have DJs, we have performances. It started in 1999 and it was an old millennium. I don't know how many of you haven't even lived in 1999. And what Chris Feigl and I did before Robexotica is artist expression using technological means already pointed us in the direction because what we did was interactive, it was psychoactive, and it was electronic. So still we were wondering what would the next millennium be like and what would interest us, what would we see, what would we like to see develop in the next few years. And one thing that may have influenced us or made the decision clear was that at this time media art was a hype thing already, but you saw a lot of stuff, you had some complicated interaction going on, but as an art consumer when you went into the exhibition, I watched lots and lots of visitors just standing like this, looking at the art and not touching it and not interacting. And so it was, we realized there's, in Germany it's Hemmschwelle, there's a barrier between the art consumer and the art. And we saw the solution in making interactive art that also elevates the spirit by intoxicating the brain. And so we thought, let's try to get some of our friends to build cocktail robots and compete in a festival for who makes the best cocktail robot. And let's proclaim it's an international festival because some friends are from Germany, and let's give out great big awards like small R2D2s and that we gilded in real gold. So actually a few people did buy in and built contraptions that either served cocktails or mixed cocktails or contributed to smoking culture. Also bar conversation was already present in the first Robexotica in 99. Then there's carte blanche category where you can pretty much come with everything and put it in a cocktail environment. If it fits, it will be considered. And this year I'm proud to announce a new category because in Vienna 3D printing is pretty much taking off in the DIY scene. We use this occasion to add a new category for 3D printed paraphernalia like glasses or smoking paraphernalia are also admitted. And it's a tradition that we also add spontaneous categories. If we have an entry that's unique in some way or it doesn't fit in any of the categories, we have some extra trophies ready for those. So, why do we do this? What do we want to achieve? Basically, as I said, it was a bold proclamation in the first. So, a funny thing after Robexotica 1999 was, I call it synchronicity, that only a few days or weeks after the event, I read the newspaper and I saw an article about a bar in London that had a real big robot behind the bar, and it was advertised that England's first robotic bar. And I took it as a sign that there actually is some need for this in the world, and we contacted the guy, and I'll show you a video in a minute. But over the years we also found other examples of people going that way in years prior to Robexotica, like even the 1980s. Ernie, our first video, he's one of these very old cochlear robots from the 80s. A robotics manufacturer from New York who sent us a video and thought it necessary to mention they apologized for the 80s hairstyles and music. The music we won't hear anyway because we don't have any speakers, but you'll see an industrial robot mixed drinks. So that by itself is nice, but it gives me opportunity to describe the philosophy of cochlear robotics as we would like to present it. It's less about efficiency, which we would see in this kind of machines, but also, or even more, grace and aesthetics. And insofar that this machine was one of a kind in the 1980s, it didn't have much competition, but these days with Robexotica stimulating more aesthetic additions to contemporary cochlear culture, this one wouldn't be an award. So with these external examples of people concerning themselves with cocktails and robots in combination, it became clear Robexotica is a thing, and we would have to continue through the years. And you wouldn't believe how long it took the creator of this machine to actually send us a video. And fun fact, we went there in 2003 ourselves because we hadn't obtained a video of this machine yet, and totally failed insofar that the bar had been sold and the robots were inoperable, so we made a documentation of fail. Because actually it's pretty expensive to maintain a robot like this. It's big, it's chunky, it has a lot of moving parts. Humanoids. Humanoids are very problematic. So a lot of machines at Robexotica don't have legs or arms, but fit the description of a robot. Some drive around. We've had one that was doing this, I don't know the word in English, but he mimicked an animal going on a rope. And you could like walk up to it and it would dispense some whiskey. So lots of interesting stuff. Go away, Cynthia. No support. Good. So I haven't shown you a video of the first Robexotica, and maybe I should, because then you get an impression of the development. Not only because the video is grainy, but because you can see one robot in its first state, in its Ur state. This one, still all wood and no decoration. And you'll see that one later on, having gone far away from those looks. Off location, we did that in, it was good enough for 3 years, but then we made a change of venue. We moved into Museumsquartier in central Vienna and teamed up with Monochrome, who at the time and still have their office there. And as soon as we did that, media showed up more often, and so here's an article from Kronenzeitung. Well, that's their idea of a cochlear robot. We never had any of this Afro-Exotica, but imagination and media are something that goes hand in hand. And that's the robot we just saw in the wooden stage, in the Ur stage. So a lot of other things developed over the years. New creations that hadn't been possible in 1999, but also old creations that got updated, upgraded. In 2008, the 10th iteration made us make a catalog. You can get it on Amazon, or I have one here. You can actually pass it along and browse it. In 2008, we also had this giant robot outside Museums Quartier. It's part of the reason why we didn't continue at Museums Quartier. Because we saw how difficult it is to work with the management. And also other circumstances changed. It would have cost a lot more to continue doing our stuff there. So in 2009, we started a nomadic experience and have moved through different locations. Most recently to Ragnarhof in 16th district, where we will also hold it this year. And that's it for the slides that I'm going to talk to. And that was pretty fast, right? But I have more. because we haven't seen a lot of the actual interesting stuff. I don't have any interesting stuff to show you, so I have to show you stuff that people talk about Exotica over the years. And I'll do that with two short videos, or one short video and a lot of slides. And during the slides you can start asking random stuff. So, but first... That's a human. And... That's nice, because it's dispensing this mist of liquid. In the background, Robo Mochi. El Español Borracho, also from San Francisco. That's Robo Mochi. It's one of those that have gone through an evolution through the years. And you'll see that one again this year. And the guy, actually, I don't want to say invented, because this kind of pump already exists, but he built it by himself, and it's it's working pretty good, this peristaltic dispensing system where you can give very exact and slow
precise
measurements. Thanks. He's making B-52s there. About the next robot. A simple line-following robot that has a task. The task is to go to a station, get a drink, and then return to the customer. That was a Swiss entry, as you may have guessed with the cow. So this is actually a mind-reading martini maker. He reads your mind, and whether you are motivated or not, you get a strong drink or not. So it's reinforcing alcoholism. It's biofeedback for adults. The smoking robot we saw. Smoking. Okay, that was a punch robot. It had a painted deer on the outside. And inside this industrial robot arm, mixed the punch, a hot drink. That's drink delivery by Cal Spaletich, one of the pioneers that I mentioned previously. Two humans. Pretending to be robots, that's also part of Robixotica. the right one, both are actually going to be there this year as well. That's the cigarette throwing robot. If you go near, this is vodka. That's the RoboMochi, the machine dedicated to making mojitos only and making them loud and looking impressive while doing it. That's another machine that excels with steel design. El Español Borracho, that we saw briefly. It's making a flaming drink, obviously. And the interesting part about it is the flamethrower was in a combat robot before being recycled into a cocktail robot. Forgot the name of this one. The mist sprayer. I really liked that. It was 2006, I think. Guy from San Francisco. Well, we do have a sister event since a couple of years. Our friends who also do the RoboGames events started the BarBot event, an annual event in the beginning of the year, in the first quarter.
So, David Hawkins?
Yeah, correct. That's Mo. You know?
Yeah.
Cool.
He advised me on my first.
Oh. Smaller. Kels Bletich's barbecue. The snappy. This one again. Actually, the flaming robot, it was Simone's. And the humanoid that we saw briefly in the video, and also a pic of him, that was David's. Yeah, most of the time he was there swearing about the servos that broke. Yeah. Detail of the RoboMochi. That was the part of it that was first. In 2002, I think it was, Robert came to Robixotica with just the slide for the lemons, for the limes. And this part is the squeezer. And that's the ice cooler. It got added, I think, 3 or 4 years into the development.
And so, was there any of the original bot after 3 generations?
Mm-hmm.
That was the same bot, they just mm-hmm. added more stuff. Mm-hmm.
Right.
That's cool.
Yeah. Yeah, he might have added something this year too, but I'm not sure. He has an extra robot this year, so he might not have had the time to add something. Okay. That's an example. I like to use for what a cocktail robot should not be. It was way too efficient, and actually it's a company renting them out, so it's for parties and stuff, and it has to be efficient, but it's not what we want to call a cocktail robot. That's what we want to call it.
More art, less efficiency.
Right. It has to fit into the environment, it has to add something in the best case. Lights that blink. Doesn't hurt if it talks to you. Yeah, David Plotkin says he talks to you and it talks.
It talks back.
Oh, you agree.
And last year you also had the pancake making robots, so like
right.
food processing robots. That's also allowed sort of at Robux.ca, or how
yeah,
is that?
I would call that an other achievement. So
okay.
I think he got the award, or I don't know.
Yeah.
He's
okay.
Coming again this year, so.
Yeah.
That's a trophy from 2 years back. And these are this year's trophies. So you see 14 times we've had this madness. That was nice. From Colorado, or Colorado, or whatever. It's you could actually create the mix yourself by playing this organ, this non-touch organ, because with proximity sensors. The layabot. That one is efficient too, but I like him still because he's also reliable and they are record breaking, and I think they can get Cynthia out of the book of the Guinness Book of Records, which they ridiculously applied to for most cocktails served by a robot. And those guys have a counter in it, and each year at Rob Exotica they add. And I think if someone takes the time and writes the Guinness Book, I think.
So they actually accepted the award? The Guinness Award?
Yes,
they,
Cynthia is in the Guinness Book as far as I know.
That's funny. That's great.
Yeah, I think all you need is fill out the application, have a witness or whatever. Next Robic Exotica, thanks for asking, is December 6th through 9th. And if you pick up one of those, you will find all the necessary information, including the web address and the robot, which isn't actually up to date, but how many of you are coming anyway? So.
What is best to come? You would have one day to the opening or to the closing ceremony? What would you recommend?
Tough call. Though I tend to advise the closing ceremonies, the awards, because you get a nice overview of what has been working over the days, and on the first night you'll not always see everything working. Partly because some things broke so soon or aren't ready yet, but partly also because there's really the largest crowd on the opening day and you don't get to all the machines. So.
Yeah. And the closing ceremony, when does it start? Sunday?
8 o'clock. On the program, I think in real life it would be 9 o'clock.